to the afternoon session of this Brewers Group conference, of which we have three excellent speakers. Our first speaker is Ian Milne. Ian has had a 40-year career in industry and merchant banking. He now devotes himself to the cause which is of so much concern to all of us here today: how to secure Britain's exit from the European Union. He is chairman of Global Britain and author of the Bruges Group publications Lost Illusions, British Foreign Policy, and The Single Market and British Withdrawal. He's also author of a comprehensive analysis of the net economic costs of UK membership of the European Union, entitled A Cost Too Far, and A Time to Say No, Alternatives to EU Membership. Today, Ian will give us his considered case for how the process of withdrawal should be pursued. Ladies and gentlemen, Ian Milne.
From a practical nuts and bolts point of view to do get, what is the managerial or the administrative process that will achieve that? What I think we should do is, on triggering Article 50, say to the EU, we've triggered it and we are leaving exactly a year from now, and we will, on the leaving date a year from now, we will pay you this year's net British contribution to the EU budget, which by then will probably be at least £14 billion. So that's three aircraft carriers, four aircraft carriers, it's that kind of thing. And by withholding the money, as you say, we're leaving, and saying we'll pay you once around in a year's time, I think that will provide a powerful incentive to the folks in Brussels to get on with. Now, the next thing is Brussels. My proposal is that we create a new, brand new, temporary ministry. And that ministry is called the Ministry for EU Transitional Arrangements, META, or META for short. META will extract the UK from the EU. Once that's done, META will be one. In other words, META is a temporary British ministry. I don't think that we should assume that the EU will drag its feet and endlessly spin out the withdrawal negotiations. For one thing, there's this massive trade imbalance between us and the rest of the EU. It is so colossal that no EU country in its right mind, without Germany, which is the main constituent of a massive British trade deficit, is going to want to mess around with their exports of cars and cheeses and curtains and window frames and whatever to our country. They won't let it happen. The German car manufacturers will not let that happen. The Japanese car manufacturers of plants in this country will not let that happen. Renault, Nissan, who made a stupid comment the other day about having to reconsider what they left to do, they won't let it happen either. The Sunderland plant of Renault Nissan is one of the most profitable plants on the planet. And not many people realize this, but I did the numbers a couple of years ago, and there's a paper on Keith's bookshop upstairs. Britain is no longer a significant car consumer market. We, last year or 2 years ago, we came in at number 13. Iran, 2 years ago, built more cars than Britain did. So, for us, the British car manufacturing sector is a success, it's doing very well. But if you're looking at it sitting in Tokyo, or sitting in Munich, in BMW, or sitting in Wolfsburg, in Volkswagen, UK market, is it in the EU or outside? Who the hell cares? We'll be on and continue manufacturing there and continue supplying. So, that's the first thing, the trade imbalance. Now, with the EU, the other thing, of course, is that Brexit, i.e. Britain leaving the EU, is not just a matter of concern and interest for Britain and continental EU. It's also a concern for the United States, for China, for Japan, in fact, the rest of the world. They will not want, the rest of the world either, will not want the EU and the UK to mess around, fool around, endlessly delay the exit negotiations once clearly and emphatically the British people in a referendum have said they want out. So they will also apply pressure to negotiators in Brussels and London to arrive at a rapid settlement. Next thing is that, as people have mentioned today already, British exit will not be the end of matters. British exit will be the beginning of matters. And there will be other EU countries which say to themselves, well, if Britain's getting out, perhaps we should get out as well. And it is one of these highly significant also, will be one of these highly significant geopolitical things where it could be the blow that fractures the post-war consensus, so that's 50, 60 years of consensus, that the way to organize trade and defense and everything else in the world today is through blocks, BLOCS, blocks. That, ladies and gentlemen, is what George Orwell brilliantly wrote about in, I think, 1945, 1946.
1948.
Okay. So, blockism, which is what the EU is all about, and what you could argue all these regional things are all about, is old hat. It's at least a generation out of it. We are today, for better or for worse, and I think for better, living in the weightless economy, the internet, etc. And that kind of future force, our children and grandchildren, is simply not susceptible to be conceptualized or analyzed or thought of in terms of blocks. So, once we've said we're leaving, it will be everybody's interests in the whole world, apart from our own interests, for negotiators back in Europe, Brussels and here, to get on with it rapidly and honestly and in good heart. Now, how complicated will the exit process be? In terms of intricacy and complexity, a UK-EU exit agreement will be comparable to a major engineering and construction project. Crossrail, which is now going on, as we speak, almost under our feet, the biggest civil engineering project in Europe, is just one example. The London Olympics, by the skin of its teeth, probably, nevertheless, is another example of a huge, complex project that was finished on time and more or less on budget. Let's think of the few years ago, 10 years ago, or 12 years ago, the high-speed railway between St Pancras and Waterloo and Folkestone going to the Channel Tunnel. That also was engineered, constructed, came in on time and on budget. And if you think of the tunnel itself, another tunnel, that is a genuinely impressive example of a Franco-British engineering achievement, and which incidentally had nothing to do with the EU. Looking even further back, in our own history, 70 years to 1944, to the multinational D-Day landings in advance of the landing in Normandy. That's another staggering example of a hugely intricate, complex, and dangerous project, which again came off. Nearer to our time, but going back 30, 40 years, I think to this country and look at what Singapore and Hong Kong have become today, and I think it could be intellectually and in terms of their governance and structure and huge success. Part of it is naturally to do with local populations there, but a lot of it is to do with our conceptual and managerial and constitutional experience and skills. So all these multidisciplinary projects. Engineering, nurturing and smart vehicles, scientists, engineers, mathematicians, construction companies, accountancy firms, consultant engineers, law firms, dozens of subcontractors, if not hundreds of subcontractors. They're very, very complex. And another example, less complex but still pretty complex, when one multinational company takes over another multinational company, and I used to be involved in that sort of thing in the city, those negotiations and agreements are incredibly complex. And so, as we speak in the city of London, at the moment, there are probably dozens of major British and overseas investment banks, law firms, accounting firms, who are negotiating, structuring, and funding such takeovers every day of the week. That experience will undoubtedly be called on when Brexit begins. So, ladies and gentlemen, what's the moral? The moral of all this is that in this country, we can do huge and complex projects. And I put it to you that all the drive, talent, creativity, management skills for conducting a successful, rapid Brexit are here on our doorstep. That's the good news. The less good news is this. The record of the British government in designing, creating, and delivering major projects is, how shall I put it? I won't mention HS2 or a new London Airport, but you get the picture. So it seems to me that the Brexit process of this country, we should maximise private sector involvement and minimise government, British government involvement. So in practice, what does that mean? Well, as I said a few minutes ago, we set up this new ministry called META. We recruit a full-time chief executive, probably on a two-year contract, extendable to 5 years, from the private sector, with experience of running these massive, complex projects that I just alluded to. He might, by the way, or she, they might be from the armed forces, because even with our sadly reduced armed forces at the moment, if you're running an operation like Afghanistan, legal side building is a good thing or bad thing. That is also an incredibly complex operation. So the person with this experience could be in the private sector, but he could also, or she could also be in the armed forces. Now he or she would report to a part-time non-executive chairman, and that person would be a senior cabinet minister from the ruling party, who in turn would report to the prime minister. And the part-time deputy chairman would be a senior shadow minister from the then opposition, because Brexit is not a party political thing. Brexit is the whole country, irrespective of whatever your party allegiance happened to be. Now, how do we structure this new ministry? This ministry, by the way, will look at, first of all, whatever negotiation there has to be with the EU in Brussels. It will also be looking at the rest of the world and what to do, if anything, about negotiating new arrangements with the United States, Australia, etc. Let me stick, for a moment, anyway, to Brussels. What we have to ask ourselves is, with whom and with what would we be negotiating Brexit in Brussels? As we know, and indeed Professor Vorbeer referred to it this morning, the bureaucracy in Brussels is no doubt deliberately structured in an incredibly complicated and Byzantine way. However, I think it's fair to say that the Commission and its 33 directorates, most headed by a commissioner, are where, for better or worse, the detailed business gets done. Six of those directorates, if not more, let's assume it's six for the time being, are admin, translation, interpretation, IT, premises, all that sort of stuff. We can put them to one side. That leaves 27 Brussels directorates with which Meta will be negotiating British exit. So it seems to me that for the European side of Meta's responsibilities, it needs to be organised into 27 departments, each one mirroring the corresponding department in Brussels. And the head of each of those departments will conduct the transition process for those members for which he or she is responsible, with the Commission sitting in Brussels on the other side. And the head of those departments, those Meta departments, will liaise as appropriate with, on one hand, the British private sector, on the other hand, with the British public sector, bodies affected by the exit and the transition. Existing Westminster ministries, Treasury, Foreign Office, Business, Agri-Fish, Defence, etc., etc., they all report to Meta on all transition matters. And Meta will be principally staffed by senior executives from the British private sector, business, transport, energy, city, farming, fishing, military, legal sector. And the latest project management techniques will be brought into the private sector to ensure the transition process runs smoothly and delivers on time. And in my plan, anyway, the Meta will complete the both of its work 1 year after the result. But it will remain in the business for a lot of years for any leftover issues. Now, personnel, not all of the Meta heads of the department will be British. Some of them, especially the trade-related ones, will be Australian or Canadian or Norwegian or Singaporean, with current experience for their countries of sitting and voting at the World Trade Organization in their own right, which we have not been able to do since 1973, believe it or not, and also current experience of negotiating free trade agreements worldwide on behalf of. Just as an aside, a lot of whinging from the Eurofunds saying, oh gosh, if we left, all our trade agreements would disappear. Well, from a legal point of view, they might. But on the 15th of April of this year, 6 months ago, China signed a complicated free trade agreement with Iceland. That suggests to me that the minute we're out from under the EU arrangements, the rest of the world will be knocking on the door saying, please can you sign free trade agreements with me? Civil servants. Now, as the Speaker mentioned this morning, civil servants could be a problem. So, as a rule, they will not be recruited to work for Meta. But let me qualify this. I don't want to be unfair or unkind about the civil servants. There are quite a few of them, even the foreigners. In fact, one of them sits in one of our Far Eastern embassies, and he is on the shortlist along with Kieran for the Brexit Conference. So that's at least one example, but I know several others as well. So quite a few civil servants are actually on our side, and many of them are highly paid. However, most of them have spent careers under a succession of Eurofile British governments enthusiastically transposing EU regulation into British law. And that's not meant as a criticism of solicitors, that's what their job has been. But it's just that their experience is the very opposite of what metal means. Neither of them ever recruit people from, this is a long, messy phrase, the transnational quinocracy. And of course, the EU is a particularly expensive, corrupt, flagrant example of that. But, you know, the World Bank, the IMF, the United Nations, there are literally hundreds of such bodies. The International Criminal Court, very, very dodgy indeed. The International Panel on Climate Change, even dodgy. So, Meta will not be involved in these long-standing organizations. Just a touch brief, because the time is running on. Although one of Meta's jobs is to negotiate the Brussels, the other one, as I said, is to liaise with and help other countries around the world, USA, Commonwealth, Japan, and so on. And it will provide for them a single telephone number for any problems or issues arising from the exit of the British from the EU. Now, when it comes to negotiation, you can get things done 10 times quicker face-to-face than you can by the internet, email, it's clear to me that for the duration of the negotiations, not just for Brussels, but for the world, NATO must have a physical presence in Brussels itself. It's clear to me also that that physical presence cannot, must not, and should not be in the various UK embassies, delegations, and whatever there are in Brussels. So, my plan is that NATO will take separate, independent, spacious, prestigious, and rather expensive office premises in Brussels, close to the ESO, the Eurostar terminal, and the Canada meeting. And those premises would, I'm being serious by the way, those premises would include conference rooms, offices, decent accommodation, cafeterias, computers, IT people, etc. The whole bank. There'd be multilingual people there in case of any problem in not speaking English or in Greek. Back in London, equally, I think it's vital that the matter of the airport away from Westminster. At least 20 minutes away from Westminster. And my plan would be that they would rent equally state-of-the-art expensive premises within a 5-minute walk of the St. Pancras Eurostar terminal. It sounds a silly thing to talk about premises at this stage, but it's highly important. I've spent a lot of my time abroad negotiating with various businesses and ministers, etc. There is no other way of doing it at the end of the day, except face to face. And we haven't got the energy, we've got to get on. So that's my plan. It's not the only way to deliver Brexit. And I very much hope that others can come up with better plans. But what I'm absolutely concerned with is this. If as a country we're serious about getting on with the EU, we have to get serious about the boring stuff. What I've just been talking about. Organization, structure, personnel, mechanics, process. You know, stuff like, should we negotiate a free trade agreement with Timbuktu? That's policy, that's interesting. But the boring stuff also, we need to take it very seriously. We cannot just leave it to the office junior in the cabinet office. Well, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, let me finish on a cheerful, upbeat note. Some of you may find this a bit common. The day approaches where, as somebody once said 4 centuries ago, this sect of Ireland, this earth of majesty, this other Eden, this Derry Babylon, this blessed plot, will regain its nation. Let we have a few baptize that day, Independence Day, and may that day be celebrated every year for centuries to come as a special landmark.